Welcome to online worship at Easter Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Steve, and it is Palm Sunday. We are so excited. We've come to the end of our Lenten journey, and we are beginning Holy Week. So grab your palm branches, get ready to wave them during the service. We've got something big planned for you. It's going to be great. Pastor Megan is preaching today as she leads us through the story of Jesus entering the city of Jerusalem. We look forward to that. But before we get to worship, I've got just one big announcement for you. You know what this means, right? Since today is Palm Sunday, that means it is Holy Week. It's coming. It's here. There's three big days that we celebrate this week. The first is Maundy Thursday. That means Commandment Thursday. Jesus said, love one another, and this is my commandment. And so we come together on Thursday to celebrate the Last Supper that Jesus had with his disciples, which is our First Communion. And speaking of First Communion, pray for our First Communion students who are coming at a special service on Thursday where they will take their First Communion. It's going to be great. But if you would like to celebrate Maundy Thursday, you can do it in multiple ways. We're going to have a noon service live on the hill. We're going to live stream that, and you can watch it online. Or make your reservation for the 6:30 Maundy Thursday service at Easter on the Hill. And then Friday, as we come to the cross, we observe Good Friday in a tenebrae service online, a service of shadows as we read scripture and lead darker and darker to the cross. And then at 5 o'clock at Easter by the lake, we have an in-person service where we're going to have some live art, some prayer, music, as we recognize the cross. And then at 8 o'clock at Easter on the Hill, we have an in-person tenebrae service. And then Saturday, we wait as Jesus is in the tomb. And then Sunday morning, it's the big day. It is Easter Sunday at Easter. So many ways that you can celebrate. There will be the online service, as always, two different options, one traditional, one contemporary band-led. And then we have in-person service at Easter on the Hill, in-person at Easter by the lake in the parking lot. Check out the website, easter.org/worship, for all the details. We hope that you will make this Holy Week extra special. But now it's time to wave our palm branches and welcome Jesus into the city. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh, Please pray with me the prayer of the day. Everlasting God, in your love for all people, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature. Know our sorrows and face death for our sake. In your mercy, enable us to share in his faithfulness and in the joy of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Well, hello. It is so good to be with you today. This is a fantastic day, right? It is Palm Sunday, and I'm going to read for you from our Spark Bible the story of Palm Sunday and then talk about it just a little bit. So here's the story. Friends, Jesus says to his disciples, I need to go to Jerusalem. I've got some important things to do, and I want to celebrate Passover with you there. Will you come with me? Sure, said the disciples. Passover is a great holiday, such good food, and what a wonderful story. Passover celebrates the exodus of God's people, the Israelites, from Egypt. It's good to be with friends and family at Passover. So Jesus and his friends started to go to Jerusalem. When they got close to the city, Jesus says, I'd like two of you to go borrow a donkey in the next village. Please tell the owner that I need it. He'll understand. When the two friends came back with a donkey, Jesus climbed on its back, rode down the hill into the city of Jerusalem, and the disciples followed behind him. Suddenly, they found themselves in a parade. People were singing and shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna! Here comes God's King! Hosanna! Praise God! People all over heard the shouting and the singing, and they joined the parade too. Hundreds of people, thousands of people. They started taking off their coats and laying them on the ground for Jesus and the donkey to walk on. They pulled palm branches down from the trees and waved them as they sang. Then they threw their palms in the ground to make a path for Jesus. That's pretty cool. The crowds gave Jesus a royal welcome as he rode into the city just like a king. But Jesus was a very different king. He was the King of Peace. Not everyone understood that. Jesus was not at all what they were expecting. They thought the crowd was too loud and the parade getting too big. Who is that man? Someone asked. What is going on here? Asked another. And the crowd answered, this is Jesus, God's King. He has come to save us. Some of the religious leaders murmured, hush, Jesus, tell your friends to be quiet. It's way too loud here. But Jesus says, we can try to make these people be quiet, but that wouldn't make a difference because today the whole earth is celebrating. This is such an amazing story because as you heard, the Israelites were welcoming a king. They were welcoming Jesus, thinking that he was going to change everything. And he did, and he does. But not in the way that they expected. Jesus came as this king of love and this king of peace and this king of serving people. The Israelites thought he would be a completely different king. But that's who Jesus is. Jesus is the king of love. He's the king of peace. And he's the king that came to serve everyone. So as we celebrate today, as we celebrate this parade, as we celebrate Palm Sunday, remember, the whole earth is rejoicing and singing and praising God and praising Jesus, excited that he is here, excited that everything will change. Will you pray with me? Hey, God, we give you thanks for this day in which your Son, the King of love, the King of peace, came to us to celebrate, to bring love, and to bring us hope. Amen. Thank you, guys, and have an amazing day.
A reading from Luke, chapter 19, verses 29 through 44. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to praise God joyfully, with a loud voice, for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, if you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you, surround you, and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you. They will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God.
Beloved in Christ, grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Alfred Nobel, the 19th century Swedish chemist and inventor, worked to create the stabilization of nitroglycerin. He originally wanted to call it Nobel's safety powder, but he instead called it dynamite. Nobel made a fortune off this substance, which created maximum damage with minimal effort. In 1888, Nobel's brother died in France, and a French newspaper mistakenly published an obituary for the wrong Nobel brother. The obituary was a scathing indictment of Alfred Nobel, proclaiming that the merchant of death is dead. Well, after reading how the world judged him and his work, Nobel quietly placed all of his money into a trust, which funds the Nobel Prizes to this day. The Nobel Peace Prize, in particular, is his effort to hail the peacemakers when he had spent his life perceived as a destroyer. The 1979 recipient of Nobel's Peace Prize was Blessed Teresa of Calcutta, known by most as Mother Teresa. Her full dedication to providing care to the poor, especially those suffering from illnesses like tuberculosis or AIDS, is recognized globally as an example of what it means to fully give yourself away out of love for God and love for others. Her success had nothing to do with power, domination, wealth or notoriety, but only with a self-emptying dedication to others. She was quoted as saying, "God doesn't ask that we succeed in everything, but that we are faithful." Two lives lived at different times, on different continents, with different purposes. But both realized that real, life-changing power, one that makes for true peace, comes from an emptying of self. Both of them knew that hope could be found in the midst of suffering. Both were willing to die to themselves, Nobel by leaving his entire fortune behind, and Teresa by facing illness and poverty openly and fearlessly. Both realized that we are called not to power and control, but to affirm others by dying ourselves. Both of them defeated death for the sake of others with life-giving sacrifice. The Palm Sunday reading that we just heard, it's often referred to as the triumphal entry for the pomp and ceremony that surround Jesus as he enters Jerusalem. We hear the disciples shouting, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord," and we are overjoyed to join our voices with theirs. We claim Jesus as God. We celebrate him as our King. And today, we raise our voices and palm branches to declare our own hosannas alongside those of his followers 2,000 years ago. There is a sense of power on this day. A recognition that Jesus comes in glory to defeat death and sin and the devil and human brokenness and promises us life with him. Those who greeted Jesus at the gates of Jerusalem, they had seen and heard of his power, healing, teaching, raising from the dead, miraculous works that proved his might and his glory. The people that greeted Jesus in our reading from today, they lived as subjects of the oppressive Roman forces, and they assumed that any Messiah that would come would bring peace to them by overthrowing their enemies and making Israel mighty again like the days of King David. We also want a Jesus who fights at our side, one who is all power and majesty, one who we praise on Palm Sunday and adore on Easter Sunday, one in whom there is no weakness. We need a word like that this year. We need that praise, that hosanna, that blessed be. We need to affirm Jesus' power over death. This is our second pandemic Holy Week. We want, we need, we must affirm a Jesus who destroys death, who overcomes oppression and hatred and anger, who brings ferocious and furious life, because we know how forcefully death comes bursting in. And so, it is a little bit of a surprise to hear Jesus responding to the shouts, the praise, and the songs with tears. The glory and rejoicing cause him to weep. He stands at the gates of Jerusalem, the city that will see his final days, and he lifts not a warrior's roar, but instead a tear-streaked face. He responds to the praise with lament. If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. You did not recognize the time of your visitation from God. This is no conquering hero. How can this man destroy our anxiety, our loss, our grief? How does this bring life after a year full of death? See, we think we know what kind of God we want, but it's not the kind of God we get, because it's not the kind of God we need. We think we want someone who will level the path, clear our obstacles, destroy all opposition, and we get confused and frustrated and defeated when we end up facing the natural struggle and loss and pain of life. We cannot see God's action in our lives because we'll only ever see what we want to see. And so Jesus laments. He weeps, not for himself and the suffering that he will face, but for the people who won't even realize who he is and why he comes. And in spite of this, He doesn't stop. Knowing what will face him, he chooses it anyway. We get a king who destroys the power of death not through domination and control, but through sacrifice, through love, even through grief. In affirming our humanity and fallibility and loss, Jesus himself faces the fragility of being human, the depth of failure, the fullness of loss. After a year like the one we've had, might we see that this is what we've always needed? The things that make for peace are not power, domination, control, supremacy. The things that make for peace are self-emptying, service, sacrifice, love. We are able to recognize this in people like Alfred Nobel or Mother Teresa, but somehow we struggle to recognize it in our God. We think we want a God who dominates. Instead, we get a God who weeps. We think we want a God who destroys enemies. Instead, we get a God who is himself killed and buried in a tomb. We think we want a God who is for us, and instead, we get a God who is for all people, including the ones we might despise. We think we want a God who is power and destruction. Instead, we get a God who sits with us in our grief, acknowledges our loss, and weeps with us. It might not feel like power and success and dominion, but it does feel real, honest, authentic, necessary. It feels like an affirmation of the struggle of life and hope, hope for the one who sees us, who knows us, and will face death for us. And so, remember, if we hear only the fanfare and praise of Palm Sunday or Easter, we don't hear the full truth. Listen. On Maundy Thursday, when Jesus gives his very self to his disciples, on the same night that they will betray and deny him. Listen on Good Friday, when Jesus is nailed to the cross and dies willingly out of love for us. Let yourself sit in the agony and loss as Christ is laid in the tomb and the disciples do not proclaim him as their king, but instead run and hide. Hear, listen, that the things that make for peace come in God's redemptive rejection of power, choosing instead weakness to be with us. May our Savior's grief draw you closer to the heart of God. May you recognize on this day that God has come to be with you, not in power, but in peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.
to me. Love to the loveless shown that they might lovely be. Oh, who am I that for my sake my Lord should take frail flesh and die? He came from his blessed home, salvation to bestow.
Please join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
My name is Stephen Gray. I serve on Easter's Vision Board and have been a member of Easter for over 20 years. I love that Easter boldly proclaims the mission of carrying on the work of Jesus Christ, and recognizes the continued work of Jesus means love in action, love that meets the needs of this particular time and place.
My name is Maren Wallenberg, and I'm a member of Easter Lutheran Church, along with my husband, Kevin, and our young daughter. I'm an educator and continue my lifelong journey of becoming an anti-racist. I am also a member of the Racial Equity Leadership Team here at Easter. I have had the opportunity to engage in several book studies over the past few years at Easter Church, most recently this summer with White Fragility, and then this fall with How to Be an Anti-Racist. During this time of conversation, reflection, and prayer with members of our faith community, it has become clear that we are committed to working towards a more just and faith-filled journey of becoming anti-racists, while allowing the space and time needed to hear voices other than our own. I know we are all on a different part of the journey as we seek to learn, grow, and understand what it means to be Black, Indigenous, or a person of color in our current society. I am inspired by the work that is being done on so many different levels within our faith community to move forward in our understanding of what it means to seek racial justice in an unjust world. I am encouraged to know that we have many faith partners along with us in the journey, including the ELCA, St. Paul Synod, and many South Metro churches.
Because God calls us to love our neighbor as ourselves in this complex world, Easter Lutheran Church will vote on a resolution to work for racial justice at the annual meeting on April 18th.
I ask that you take time to read Easter Lutheran Church's Commitment to Racial Justice resolution prior to our annual meeting. I ask that you look deeply at the document, looking for ways to have a conversation, whether that is with another member of our faith community, yourself, or God.
I invite you to visit Easter.org to read the resolution and take some time to reflect on it before the annual meeting. It serves as a public commitment that Easter will learn and grow into God's vision for a more loving and inclusive community.
Where do you enter into this conversation? Where do you find opportunities to learn and grow? How is God calling you to this work that must be done?
More than ever before, Easter will integrate a clear message on racial justice into every possible area of ministry.
This is not an easy journey, as we often are being asked to examine ourselves, our society, and our deeply rooted systems that continue to produce racism. However, it is a journey that we don't have to go alone, as we have our faith community to support us. As someone who has seen the unjust systems that our neighbors near and far endure on a daily basis, I know how vital it is that we begin to have conversations, continue to learn, and seek justice for all of God's children.
We invite you to join us in the work of love for the sake of our community and our congregation, understanding that truly, God calls us to love our neighbors as ourselves. We invite your support, your prayers, your time, your energy, and your dollars as we continue to do the work of love.
As Dr. Ibram X. Kendi states in his final message in his book, How to Be an Anti-Racist, if we ignore the odds and fight to create an anti-racist world, then we give humanity a chance to one day survive, a chance to live in communion, a chance to be forever free.
Please pray with me the offering prayer. God, you have given us your Son, whose gift of life is our greatest treasure. As we follow him, praise him, and bow down before him, we ask your mercy. Lead us into Holy Week with humility and hope, as we faithfully return all these gifts to you, ready to hear of your love, made known in the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. In whose name we pray. Amen.
Praising our Savior's name and devoted to the things that make for peace, we pray for the church, the world, and all God's creation. We glorify and praise you, Jesus, knowing you are our Lord and King. Still, we confess our willingness to shout hosannas without having to stand at the foot of your cross. Call us closer to you, that we would hear the truth of your self-emptying love for the sake of all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We glorify and praise you, Jesus, for your power over sickness and death. Still, we are overwhelmed by the needs of many that we love. bring your compassion and wholeness to Brent Bajou, Kevin Lane, Michael Williams, Dale Hebel, Shannon Arndt, Jody Taylor, Melinda Martin. Send your spirit to Cindy Lutz, Sue Montgomery, and any who grieve, that they would know your coming Easter promise of life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We glorify and praise you, Jesus, for your word of life at work across the world. Bless our companion congregations in Guatemala City and Maya Itza, Guatemala, and Nyanzawa, Tanzania, as we proclaim your gospel with one voice. Give your love and mercy especially to those people of Tanzania as they grieve the death of their president, John Magufuli. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We glorify and praise you, Jesus, for your unrelenting call to love and serve our neighbors. Make us agents of peace, especially for members of the Asian and Pacific Islander communities facing increased acts of violence and hatred, and for the victims of the shooting in Boulder, Colorado. Call us to action, show us your wisdom, and fill us with your spirit's power so we all would know security and worth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We glorify and praise you, Jesus, for the hope that dawns among us. We praise you for signs of spring life all around us. We celebrate the increase of COVID vaccinations and devote ourselves to continued safe practices to slow the spread of the disease. We look to a new world, not the old normal, that we might be faithful to who we are as your people now, after all we have been through by your grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We glorify and praise you, Jesus, at the beginning of Holy Week. Focus our attention on the story of your passion. Draw us closer to your side, even as it forces us to look on your suffering and death. Open our eyes to your work of love today, this week, and always. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray all these things, praising your name and humbled by your sacrifice, trusting that you hear us as we rejoice or as we weep, for you are our Savior who taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me.
Oh, it's been great to be together on this Palm Sunday. Wasn't it great to see all the kids waving those palm branches? I hope it set the tone for you as we enter into this Holy Week. And so now as we leave this place, go with this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.